We're sky, glorious King, wonderful Savior. Glorious God, the glorious King, the wonderful Savior. The glorious God, the glorious King, the wonderful Savior. The glorious God, the glorious King, wonderful Savior. The glorious God, the glorious King, the wonderful Savior. The glorious God, the glorious King, the wonderful Savior. The glorious God, the glorious King, the wonderful Savior. The glorious God, the glorious King, the wonderful Savior. The glorious God, the wonderful King, the wonderful Savior. And we worship. Yes, I am my beloved, and he is mine, and I and bless them, Lord. Oh, my soul, and all that is within me. Oh, bless them, Lord. Oh, my soul, and all that is within me. Oh, bless them, Lord. Oh, my soul, and all that is within me. Oh, bless.
To him who was
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Christ Jesus. Worthy is the Lamb. Forever. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb, and this sings my soul. Yes, this sings my soul. Oh, this sings my soul. Oh, this sings my soul. This sings my soul. This sings my soul. Oh, this sings my soul. Oh, you are ever faithful.
Praise.
praises rise and ring to the King. For the praises rise and ring to you. We give thanks, we bring praise to you, Lord. We give thanks, we bring praise to you, Lord. We give thanks and we bring praise to you, Lord. We give thanks and we bring praise to you, Lord. We give thanks and we bring praise to you, Lord. We give thanks and we bring praise to you. We give thanks and we bring praise to you.
What an awesome privilege it is that we get to bring praise to the Lord, to the maker of all things, creator of the ends of the earth, who faints not, neither grows weary.
We give thanks and we bring praise to you, Lord. We give thanks and we bring praise to you.
to you. Wonderful, merciful, sovereign, we give thanks. We bring praise to you. Sing it with me just one more time. We give thanks and we bring praise to you. Well, welcome everyone this morning. We're so blessed you're here. So glad to see you guys. Pastor Mark's been ministering, and I believe it's North Dakota, and he'll be back this evening. Hallelujah. 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 Lord, we enter your gates with thanksgiving and your courts with praise. Rejoicing in the Lord, rejoice in the Lord. My soul magnifies you, my body and spirit glorify you, Lord. So wonderful, wonderful, merciful, compassionate, gracious, amazing God. Well, again, welcome. You may be seated. We're going to minister the word a little bit here this morning. Primarily be talking out of 2 Kings 7 this morning. But we're going to start off with 2 Kings 6:24 to get a little background here. And this is a passage of scripture that always amazes me, catches me. I have to read really slow through this part. And a couple of highlights before, just to give you some background. And kind of place of this is we have Elisha, right? Elijah's now gone. Elisha has taken up the mantle, the double portion that God has given him. And what's amazing within this context is you have Elisha, the man of God, who already, there's been countless examples that would confirm his ministry, that would basically give you a hint or clue that you probably shouldn't mess with the man of God. For example, in 2 Kings 2, I believe it is, verse 23 to 24, the King James calls them lads. 42 of the lads start mocking the prophet Elijah. Go up, bald head. Go up, bald head. Just, you know, these little things. And with messing with Elisha, messing with the anointing, two female bears come out and rip the kids to shreds, 42 of them, which is pretty amazing. But it speaks to the sacredness of the anointing and of the man of God and the ministry of God. And we are so blessed in this place to have Pastor Mark, who has stood faithful countless times, though few have come and many have come at times. And it's just been such an awesome privilege and blessing to be a son in the house. And that's not only for me, that's is for several of you that have been sons and daughters in the house getting raised up. Because there is a price, a cost for proclaiming the word of the Lord. There's a cost for not just doing the ebb and flow as confined to what men would confine about what's acceptable, about boundaries we don't cross, and many of you know this. But it's so precious to me, the anointing that has been placed in this church and the ministry here, the presence of God, it's unlike anything else I've ever experienced. And when you've gone away for a bit and been a part of other churches, you have that more of an appreciation for it. So let me just encourage you, don't undervalue or get used to, become insensitive to what is in this place. The mantle is on this place, but I encourage you to press into it further and do not be discouraged, but encouraged in what God can do through you, in you and through you to those around you. Amen? So, it's just incredible. So we have two parallel things going on here that I want to touch on. One of them is the word of the Lord and the reaction to the word of the Lord. And this is very important to each one of us, of you know, how we hear the word of the Lord, as we hear it come from Scripture, as we hear it come from His ministers and His prophets in this earth, our reaction to it. Because you're going to find here in 2 Kings 7 that you may be able to, if you were reading here, almost disregard the way that this messenger approaches and asks a question to the word of the Lord and the outcome. And so, you know, this was, I'm going to touch on it quite a bit, but the way that we hear the word of the Lord and respond to it in our own lives and the potential consequences of that. Do we go by what we see around us, by what we know, or do we embrace what God says for what it is? And at times, maybe that just means keeping your mouth shut. I mean, as we go through here, we'll see this. I mean, I know I haven't read it yet to give you context, but just I'm going to let it kind of stir in the hopper of your brain and spirit right now. If when it gets here of this response that this servant or this messenger to the king has, what if he just would have kept his mouth shut? How many problems do we get in because we don't keep our mouth shut? So anyway, there's lots of points in this scripture, but let me just begin with 2 Kings 6:24. And it came to pass after this that Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, gathered all his host and went up and besieged Samaria. And there was a great famine in Samaria, and behold, they besieged it until a donkey's head was sold for 40 pieces of silver and the fourth part of a cab of dove's dung for 5 pieces of silver. So it's very dire straits. We have severe famine, and as recorded here, that's a pretty desperate record of what the economic exchange for these tokens of refuse, if I may call them that, would be. Definitely not pleasant dainties or anything like that. Let's keep going here. 26. And as the king of Israel was passing by upon the wall, there cried a woman unto him, saying, "Help my lord, O king." And he said, "If the Lord do not help you, whence shall I help you? Out of the barn floor or out of the wine press?" And the king said unto her, "What aileth thee?" And she answered, "This woman said unto me, Give thy son, that we may eat him today, and we will eat my son tomorrow. So we boiled my son and did eat him, and I said unto him on the next day, Give thy son, that we may eat him, and she hath hid her son." So I'm bringing up this point to show you a context for how desperate times had been. But not only that, there's a point here, too. We see throughout this, there's been what we can call the cycle of apostasy, where Israel turns to God, and then they backslide and start following other gods, and this cycle and repetition. And may it speak to us as well about their not allowing any kind of a cycle of one day we're good, next day we're not so good, we're distant, we kind of went our own way, but every day living for the Lord. And there's another thing too here is the part of the reason, one of the reasons for things getting this bad that you could almost say cannibalism or eating the flesh of man, or even the depravity to eat your own kids. I mean, it's almost unfathomable. But from departing from God's law, his precepts, always works this way. You know, it starts one way, turning to other gods, and let that speak to you what that is in this modern day age. Turning to other gods, following after other things, and then step by step, it can get that deplorable and depraved that, you know, you're eating your children. Fortunately, most of the kids in here are up in kids' church. They don't have to hear the beginning context of this message because it's not the most light thing. This is serious. And of course, we have the whole, with these gods and demon worship, we had the sacrifices of children. And just a quick tangent, I'm blessed that Pastor Mark's book is coming out soon because it talks a lot about the influences of Satan and his fallen angels and how the surrounding kingdoms of Israel, it explains that much further why God told Israel, you know, follow after me, seek me, don't be led astray by these other gods that are going to turn your heart. So continuing on, there's a lot I could say about this, but we'll just keep going on. In Jesus' name, this is going to be a blessing to you, and it's going to fall on prepared hearts, and that much more give you a bolstering of strength in the kingdom of God, a fortifying the fortresses of your life for the kingdom and to live for his purposes. So I believe we're in verse 30 now. And it came to pass when the king heard the words of the woman that he rent his clothes and passed upon the wall. And the people looked, and behold, he had sackcloth within upon his flesh. And he said, God, do so to me and more, if the head of Elijah, the son of Shaphat, shall stand on him this day. Probably not the best thing to do. Blame the man of God and then say, I'm taking his head. I'm going to chop off his head this day. Not very wise. But again, deception, deceit will work this way to where you can actually feel justified and saying a phrase like this, this guy's totally wrong, he's out of here. And whether that means to you, oh, I'm not going to listen to the word of the Lord by his prophets or whatever that the case may be with that, it's a troubling state and it's a sobering state about where would we not let or reverence the anointing, the word of God in our lives to have supreme preeminence, that we would be so brazen and arrogant and foul to say a statement such as this, as, I'm taking that guy's head. It's all because of this guy that my things aren't working out, and curse upon Israel. No, not even close. So 32, and I love this. Because, again, God speaks to his servants. And so before this messenger is going to even get to the house of Elijah, Elijah's going to receive revelation by the Spirit. Again, and I'm going for more of this, and I implore you to as well, Spirit knowledge, knowledge by the Spirit, that direct download of heaven where you got the ends, the knowing of what's going on in the situation. And it's amazing here, too. I'm just going to, another quick aside here is if you look in verse 12, the king of Assyria, of Syria, is having the secrets that the king of Syria is telling his bedchamber. That kind of a connection where he knows. So then we've got you'll have to look it back up if I'm wrong, but I believe the king of Syria there is afraid. He's taken back by this. Whereas we got the king of Israel over here saying, oh, I'm gonna kill the prophet. At least from my recollection over here, we have some kind of a reaction that's not. And again, I mean this loosely. Of course, these were the enemies of God's people, the king of Syria here at this point. But just the reaction, this dichotomy of reactions where the king of Israel, Jehoram here, that may not be the way to pronounce it, but it sounds pretty good, the Horam here, is wanting to kill the prophets of God. And we have that manifested, again, I'm jumping, the whore of Babylon represented, the great whore who, the spirit of Jezebel, who came out to destroy the prophets and anointed men of God. But keeping going here with just the text, verse 32. But Elisha sat in his house, and the elders sat with him, and the king sent a man from before him. But ere the messenger came to him, he said to the elders, "See how this son of a murderer has sent to take away mine head. Look, when the messenger cometh, shut the door and hold him fast at the door. Is not the sound of his master's feet behind him?" And while he yet talked with them, behold, the messenger came down unto him and said, "Behold, this evil is of the Lord. What should I wait for the Lord any longer?" And we go to chapter 7. Elisha then brings the word of the Lord here. Again, I took this time to set up, okay, what's the state right now? If you recall, we're in a bad situation. There's famine and all sorts of other terrible things going on, which should then make it much more impactful what the prophet is going to say. Then Elisha said, "Hear ye the word of the Lord." Listen up to what the Lord says, would be my quick aside of that, the way that I would phrase that. "Thus saith the Lord, tomorrow about this time shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel, and two measures of barley for a shekel in the gate of Samaria." So what the word of the Lord came was proclaiming a complete change, a complete flip around from what it was. And think about this. This is the word of the Lord. But if not recognized for what it is, you know, you may think, one may think, in this case, the messenger, and our own reasonings, how's this going to be? How can that even be? And listen to what the Lord on whose hand the king leaned on, or the messenger who was sent earlier, says, "Behold, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, might this thing be?" And I do not know if he said it something like this: "Behold, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, might this thing be?" Or if he said, "Behold, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, might this thing be?" You know, more arrogant or not. But the thing is, here's he said it. He questions the word by his circumstance, what I believe to be looking at what was going on and saying, how can this impossibility be? Without regard for just taking a moment to realize, hey, this is the man of God. Whether I'm not agreeing with this word or not, I should, if I disagree, one, it'd much be helpful if I just didn't say anything or say nothing at all, or just say, "So it be," or something. You know, Mary's response to the word, right, as recorded, is, "Be it unto me according to that word," that right heart that says, "Lord, whatever you want in my life, let it be. Let it be, so be it according to your word, as you had purposed." That right heart. So keep track of that, the right heart and the way to go about these things versus the wrong way to go about this. And I keep bringing this up because every time I read this passage of Scripture, it's amazing. You got it right there at the beginning in verse 2, and then you got it repeated at 17, and pretty much from 17 all the way to the rest of the chapter, it's devoting to recounting this reaction of this messenger. This guy forever goes down in history as the guy who questioned the word of the Lord, and so he gets an immediate judgment at this point, which is pretty remarkable. But I want to save it till the end. Those of you, several of you, know what happens to the guy. But keep this in mind as we're going on. Now we have this other part of the story, which is awesome. That's about the miracle that God will use to perform His word that has been set up to this point. At verse 3, and I love this. It's four lepers, very likely estimable candidates for this opportunity. Lepers. You're not very much in a good state when you have leprosy. Your body, as I understand it, and Dr. Stu could give us all more revelation about this, but your body is decaying and parts of you begin to fall off and rot. You're essentially rotting stage by stage until there's nothing left of you. Not very good state to be in either. But even more important spiritually, is there decay going on spiritually, where we're losing things? Parts of us that were once fiery for God that grow cold or lukewarm. So let that also kind of be an undercurrent of what's being spoken here. So here we go. The miracle that the Lord's going to use these unlikely candidates, four leprous men. Here it goes. And there were, verse 3, and there were four leprous men at the entering end of the gate, and they said one to another, "Why sit we here until we die? If we say we will enter in the city, then the famine is in the city, and we shall die there. And if we sit still here, we die also. Now therefore, come and let us fall into the host of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall live, and if they kill us, we shall but die." Verse 5, and they rose up in the twilight to go unto the camp of the Syrians, and when they were come to the uttermost part of the camp of Syria, behold, there was no man there. For the Lord, and I love this, the miracle, again, we got four lepers here. For the Lord had made the host of the Syrians to hear a noise of chariots and a noise of horses, even the noise of a great host, the sound of a great army that causes, you know, the earth to shake and whatever. I mean, we don't really have a great example of that in modern times, but if you can just imagine this thunderous force that the Lord caused them to hear, when really it was just four lepers. Barely, I could see, you know, barely just making it by. Who knows, they might have had long robes of sackcloth, gray or something that kind of tattered, and maybe just some of them limping around, maybe some of them their knees or some other part of their body is about to fall off because of their state. But the Lord uses it to be the sound of a great army, the miraculous way in which God can take the simple things and courses of our lives and make them great to fulfill His purposes. Even though we may not see them at that moment, I doubt there, as stated by them, there was a state of desperation of, we're going to die anyway. Why don't we just go see if the king of Syria will at least be merciful, or let us survive, or we can have some water or food, instead of just having the double whammy, if you will, of our bodies decaying, we're starving, we've got this whole host of things set against us. They may not have known, more than likely, they absolutely did not, that the Lord would use this to turn the whole thing around. So continuing on here, let's start back at verse 6 again to get the whole impact of this. For the Lord had made the host of the Syrians to hear a noise of chariots and a noise of horses, even the noise of a great host. And they said one to another, "Lo, the king of Israel hath hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to come upon us." Again, speaking of this force that they heard coming out against them wasn't just one kings, but a few of them, in allegiance to each other. Verse 7, "Wherefore they arose and fled in the twilight and left their tents and their horses and their donkeys, even the camp as it was, and fled for their life. When these lepers came to the uttermost part of the camp, they went into one tent and did eat and drink and carried their silver and gold and raiment and went and hid it and came again and entered into another tent and carried thence also and went and hid it." Can you imagine they find all this plunder basically lying around where they just get to go in and, you know, score, we have all this stuff. But and then not knowing what's going on here. Verse 9, "Then they said one to another, we do not well. This day is a day of good tidings, and we hold our peace. If we tarry till the morning light, some mischief will come upon us. Now therefore come, that we may go and tell the king's household. So they came and called unto the porter of the city, and they told them, saying, we came to the camp of the Syrians, and behold, there was no man there, neither voice of man, but horses tied and donkeys tied, and the tents of them as they were. And he called the porters and told it to the king's house within. And the king arose in the night and said unto his servants, I will now show you what the Syrians have done to us. So the king's going to present what he knows to be what has happened here. They know that we be hungry, therefore are they gone out of the camp to hide themselves in the field, saying,
When they come out of the city, we shall catch them alive and get into the city. And verse 13, and one of the servants, and this is great, the wisdom exhibited by the servant here of, we may not know exactly what's going on. We should check it out. So here's what he says, verse 13. And one of his servants answered and said, let some take, I pray thee, five of the horses that remain, which are left in the city. Behold, they are all the multitude of Israel that are left within. Behold, I say, they are even as all the multitude of the Israelites that consume them. And let us send and see. They took, therefore, two chariot horses, and the king sent after the host of the Syrians, saying, go and see. And they went after them unto Jordan. And lo, I love this part, and lo, all the way was full of garments and vessels which the Syrians had cast away in their haste, and told the messengers, returned and told the king. So they were fleeing for their lives, going so fast that they, you know, they barely, some of them not even getting their clothes on, they're scattered, things left behind. As it's evident of how fast they were like, we're getting out of here, this is, we're dead. We're kaput. Verse 16. And the people went out and spoiled the tents of the Syrians. So a measure of fine flour was sold for a shekel, and two measures of barley for a shekel, according to the word of God. So the word fulfilled through the action of these unlikely candidates. And then we're going to wrap up this whole miraculous story, pointing again to what we start with about the word of the Lord, how this messenger receives it and responds to it again. And we're going to find out what happens to him because of this. Exactly what unfolds with Elijah saying back in verse 2, that you shall see it but with your eyes, but you shall not eat thereof. So verse 17, and the king appointed the Lord on whose hand he leaned to have the charge of the gate. And the people trode upon him in the gate, and he died as the man of God had said, who spake when the king, when he came down to him. Now this is really, he got the charge of doing the gate, and he was overrun here. And I'm just quickened that in the way you respond to the word of the Lord, in this case in a wrong manner, can cause you to be overrun. Overrun by the things of this world. You may not see the immediate consequence as this guy did that was the gatekeeper and gets trampled to death by this, what I imagine to be an influx of people just so excited about all this complete miracle that has happened, this complete change around. But this possibility for being overrun, trampled, stomped out by the world, choking the word of God. So I was just quickened with that. Keeping on here, verse 18. And it came to pass, as the man of God had spoken to the king, saying, two measures of barley for a shekel and a measure of fine flour for a shekel shall be tomorrow about this time in the gate of Samaria. And the Lord answered the man of God and said, now behold, if the Lord should make windows in heaven, might such a thing be? Again, I'm bringing this back up. You may look at this and be like, that does not seem like too bad of a question to ask. Questioning. And he said, behold, thou shalt, this is Elisha, right, the consequence. It shall, behold, thou shalt see it with thy eyes, but you shall not eat thereof. And so it fell upon him, for the people trode upon him in the gate, and he died. And again, this correlation between not, you shall see it with your eyes, but not being able to take part. And isn't that true of when we don't acknowledge the word and the path that God has set us in, and by his ministers and through his word, if we don't line up with that and in any way hold on to what we think true and would then justify our state of why we are the way we are or why something cannot change because of what it was yesterday, how it cannot completely change today, But the miraculous working of God is all you have to do is hear the word and receive it. And the miracle happens. It may not be on our time scale as we see evident countless times through Scripture. It was many times not at all on the time scale. But there were times where there was immediate responses to things. So just encouraging you again here today, hearing the word of the Lord, waiting on the word of the Lord, having your ears open, and remember that the god of this world, Satan, that serpent, which is the devil, who beguiled man in the beginning, caused this whole chaos and broken relationship with God, who then, you know, we're redeemed now, thankfully, through Jesus Christ. But the reality of the subtlety that he can come in and sow a word or bring questioning that can be justified. So that's what I know I keep hammering on it. But just as a reminder, I think we always need to be reminded of it throughout our daily lives as well, is, Lord, search me and know me, examine me. Lord, if there's been any way that the word, your word, if it's come by your prophets, by your ministers, Pastor Mark, by your word, evident that you've spoken to me, that has choked it out, that would cause me to be unfruitful, that I could see others around me stepping into a blessing, but I'm not seeing it. I've been trampled. I'm not getting it. And the words that the scripture exactly says here in the King James, I'm not eating thereof. I'm not getting to participate in it. And if that is you, I would say, re-examine yourself. And I love, again, let me bring to your remembrance the word of God spoken by the Apostle Paul, where he says, if we would examine ourselves, we would not be judged. Wow. Examining ourselves now could prevent standing in front of God that day, then giving account and no change being able to be made. It is what it is. The judgment of God comes down, passes, and you're either well done, my good and faithful servant, or depart from me. I never knew you. Ooh, scary, scary words. Some of the scariest words in the scripture that we see, I believe in all the gospels, but I think it's Matthew 24 or 25, or around in there. The scariest words that I could ever imagine. Depart from me, I never knew you. Whew, that's heavy. But let me bring it back to the now, the good. If we examine ourselves, now, we will have means by which our life, we can conform everything about and give everything over to our life, that we are then in Christ and walking according to his word, that will judge us and be found to be faithful, profitable servants. Is this ministering to any of you this morning? So I want my lovely wife to come, but I'm just reminded of one other thing, actually, about the power of our words. And I could keep going on quite a bit, praise the Lord, about this and unfolding this passage of Scripture here about the power of our words, what we say. And I'm sure Scriptures are going off in a lot of your hearts and minds. But just the sobering reality of what we say, annulling, canceling the provision that God would have for us right there, just by us out of our own mind looking to our circumstances and those things around us and saying, how could it be if God would open up the windows of heaven? You know, a questioning about what God can do instead of complete conformity to the assurance and knowing that he is able, he's more than able. So I real quickly, as a corollary verse of Scripture, to sum this thing up, and I love summing things up with the words that Jesus spoke. So in Matthew 12:36, just to reinforce the power of our words, he says, but I tell you that every careless word that you speak, you shall give an accounting for it in the day of judgment. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. Very heavy, the judgment that is a result of our words. Those said in jesting, those said in joking, how we give an account. And I love how Pastor Mark said one of the last few times we've met, about the reality of giving account for your life every day, living through the eyes of eternity, and recognizing each day when you wake up, Lord, I will give an account for this day. Lead me, Holy Spirit, and by your power, that I might fulfill your purposes today. Because right as we, as a tree falls, there it lies. Sorry, guys, I'm just getting quickened with it. This is a wonderful place to stand in and minister by the Spirit. You just get stuff. But if the tree falls where it lies, how you are today is more than likely how you'll be tomorrow. And if you die today, it'll absolutely be that was the way you are, and you're over into eternity. And each one of us don't know what that time is. It could be for me after I leave this meeting. It could be for you the same, or it could be tomorrow during the routine of our week where it's Monday, not necessarily fun day for a lot of people. But it can be. And in Jesus' name, it will be as we take a hold. And I'm right here with you guys. This is what the Lord is speaking to me as well about the power of our words and our actions and the way we respond to his word, not only as he speaks it to us through the scripture as we read, but through his ministers, which give the greater account. What does Paul say there? Maybe it does say greater account, but this huge responsibility as the ministers of God, that what they're the ones who give account for what happens. So realize that in any situation you come through, that you more than likely do not know all the inside details. You maybe got a few, but don't use that to allow it to spin what you see like this messenger did and ended up in a bad state. Darling wife, please come up here. So the wonderful thing about it is you may say, I'm not able. And of course we're not, but it's in that realizing, in that humility, the place that I'm not able, but Lord, I know you're able. And because of that, I am well able to step into the exceedingly abundantly, to lay hold of my inheritance in God. Let me make sure I've got this right. I don't have it in my notes. I believe it's Numbers 13, where Caleb, or I think it says it a couple places, but one of them is Numbers 13, where Caleb says, we are well able. We are well able to step into our inheritance. We are well able to subdue these giants, this land that we look like grasshoppers in. And I mean, wow. Just the realizing that we are well able. We are made more than conquerors through Christ Jesus. There is nothing too big or too small from the Lord. That you say, Lord, use me. Lord, come to my aid. And in the name of Jesus, I tell this thing to get out of the way, and it has to go. Or I command this hindering spirit or oppressive thing to get out of here in Jesus' name, and it flees. Again, another quickening of scripture. Submit yourself to God. And what's the devil going to do? He's going to flee. He's going to get out of there. Hallelujah. Lord, I thank you for this people, the abiding place, this army of God that you have raised up in this land, for this generation, for this time. Lord, we thank you for this mantle of the Spirit, that more and more I see many of the youth, many of the people in this place taking hold of and saying, I take it, I lay hold of it, I'm hungry for you, Lord, I'm hungry for more, I'm desperate, God, and with desperation, God, I'm seeking after you, and I thank you for it. I thank you for the blessing, Lord, upon them, and that there be no one from this day forth listening by the web or anyone in here that ever would stop and question the word of the Lord by what they've seen and known, but rather say, yes, Lord. Would say, yes, Lord, and do it according to your purposes in me. Yes, Lord. The simple, yes, Lord, whatever you want. And I love that, the humility, the brokenness, and that's where God says he would dwell. Hallelujah. 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 I feel like I'm just getting warmed up here, but I know it's Sunday morning, and my lovely wife here, who I'm so blessed by, the most amazing woman on the face of the earth that the Lord brought to me in this place. Thank you. Yes. And any of you unmarried, just be faithful to the Lord, and he will bring the person to you. And it will be witnessed by others. So here you go.
Thank you. Hallelujah. I'm the blessed one. I'm the blessed one. He has notes. He told me, no notes, flow in the Holy Ghost. It's actually all scripture written on a piece of paper. But anyway, I am so blessed to be with you guys. I love this church. I love this church so much, and I love each and every one of you. And I'm just going to share with you guys kind of what the Lord put on my heart. We all have our own Bibles, Pastor Mark's, Pastor Joshua, my own. They're all the same thing. Just different highlights. But I have been just absolutely loving Pastor Mark's Facebook feed. Have you guys seen? He does videos about 1 o'clock every day. It used to kind of be scripture, but now he actually does 15-minute videos. And I love it. I love it. It's right at 1 o'clock usually. He's traveling a lot lately. But last week, there was our very own pediatrician, Dr. Stuart Graham, and Pastor Mark, talking about workplace evangelism. And I'm blessed. Both my children see Dr. Stuart Graham, so I can totally testify to exactly what he said and what he does in the office, and that is just preach the word of God and pray for people and take fear out of people. That's one of the biggest things, I think, as parents. Sometimes when you come in with a kid, it's just a bunch of fear. It's a bunch of things that come against you, and you just like, and he's looked at my kids plenty of times. She's fine. She's completely fine. There's nothing wrong. I'm like, she's fine. She's completely fine. That's pretty radical when you have a 1-pound miracle baby, huh? With a whole host of issues that should be going on, and you have a pediatrician tell you that she's perfectly whole. I love that I have the most amazing husband in the world, but my opening was James 4:7, what he just said. So let's turn there to James 4:7. So James 4:7, it says, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn. Weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning, and your joy into heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. Drop down with me to James 4:14. Whereas you know not what shall be on tomorrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanish away. So this month marks 5 years of my near-death experience. Today I'm still the worst medical case of HELLP syndrome and should not be walking or alive, nor should have a daughter who praises Jesus 24/7 and makes me stop at the mall to tell people that Jesus loves them and died on the cross for their sins. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And so when I watched Pastor Mark and Dr. Graham that day talk about workplace evangelism, it was just a month prior that John Ward had passed away, and that's one of Pastor Mark's best friends. And in John Ward's obituary that came up on my Facebook feed, it talked about John the Evangelist. And I always knew, I only got to meet John once, but I always knew how successful he was in business. But it wasn't that he was successful so much in business. Sure, he made great money, but he gave everyone a choice when he met them for business for eternity. That was the most important thing. And that really shook me because, you know what? John went on to glory very young, very quickly. And I should have been gone to glory very young, very quickly. But the Lord gave me a second chance. And it really made me get on my face and just say, Lord, am I doing all that you've called me to do? Am I getting, you know, comfortable in this place? Like Pastor says, you can soak or sit, soak, and then sour. I'm like, Lord, let me not be that person that comes here each week, comes in, comes out, and I don't do anything different, that I just leave this place and I go back to my comfort and my comfy couch and my comfort air conditioning and my comfort of all the things that we have here in the United States. Lord, I don't want to be that way. Lord, you gave me a second chance. Like Pastor Joshua just said, I might die today. I might not make it to Fun Day Monday. I might not make it to Terrific Tuesday or whatever else you want to call the days of the week. I might not have those days left in me. And so after I listened to Pastor Mark and Dr. Stuart Graham, I was invited to go speak at a leadership retreat with some of the top leaders in my entire company. And the lady that put it on, she said, I know you're all about Jesus, girl, so go do your thing. I said, really? She's like, oh, yeah. I'm like, okay, absolutely. I'm ready to go. Had all my notes for business, but I'm like, Father, just use me. Just use me, use me, use me. So I do my training, share Jesus in my training. Like, you know, Dr. Graham said, it's who we are. People know who we are. It's not that, like Pastor Mark said in this video last week, and if you guys don't know what I'm talking about, you can go back to Pastor Mark Spitsbergen's Facebook page. Go down to last week. There's the videos every single day, and you'll see workplace evangelism. He titles all of them. But Pastor Mark said, sometimes people feel like they need to go to Nepal. They need to sell everything, quit their job, and go to Nepal to be a missionary. It's no, you don't. God gave you workplace evangelism every single day at Trader Joe's. I can't tell you how many times Casey and Jason are saving everyone at Trader Joe's. Every time we go on a date, we go there, we see them. They're like, they're going to come to church with us, and they're going to go to church with us. Casey and I started doing walking evangelism at Lake Miramar and being able to bless these mommies, and one of them's already come to church. There's opportunities every place we go. Yesterday, We Love Orphans car washed all the youth with my little Anna washing these cars, praying with people, telling them about the love of Jesus. Every single time, every single day, if we're ready and we're willing, there is an opportunity for us to preach Jesus and share the love of Christ. And so that's what Pastor was sharing. He said, come on, you guys, we don't just have to go to Nepal. We don't have to do all this stuff. We do it where we're at. So nonetheless, I'm at Laguna Beach last Saturday, and I'm just praying and praying and praying. And I text my sisters, and I'm like, pray with me, pray with me. You know, I know that God wants to do a great thing here. And I was actually supposed to get back to school of worship. I have a 1 and 4 year old to take care of, and Joshua's going to worship practice. And I text Elizabeth, and I said, hey, can you go meet the girls? There's something that the Lord's going to do. So as I wait on the Lord, we sit down for dinner, and one of the pastors, so there's a pastor's wife there. Praise God for the pastor wives, right? And she looks at me and she's like, tell me about your testimony in Jesus. And I'm like, here it is. I knew it. So I have a captive audience. We're all sitting here, all the leaders. And I start sharing my testimony. And some of you guys might not know it. And I know a lot of you guys are watching by web today, which I'm abundantly blessed. And a lot of people will watch us by YouTube. But I wasn't raised like a lot of you guys in this church. I have amazing parents. I have 3 wonderful brothers. But we were raised in a Catholic church. I went to Catholic schools my entire life. I never understood the Bible, but that's okay. The priest said, just come to them and they'll help us out. And if you sin, you go to confession and then you say the Hail Mary and then you're good, right? Well, it didn't. It wasn't exactly like the abiding place, needless to say. And so I went on to college at University of Minnesota to play volleyball. And to the world, I had everything. I was a starter on the collegiate volleyball team. I played around 5,000 people in front of them on ESPN, dated the quarterback, had great grades, and on the outside, it looked like I had this white picket fence and everything was happy. On the inside, I wasn't. There was always this bar that was trying to be raised. I was always trying to run after it in my own might and my own ability, and inside, I felt worthless. I was depressed. I was kind of trying everything in the world that was just an empty, seeping hole, like most of you that didn't grow up with the Lord know what it's like. So my junior year, the end of my sophomore year of volleyball, my assistant volleyball coach died in front of me. And he was 36 years old, super healthy, and he was playing basketball with some of my friends and just dropped dead. And I don't know if you've ever had anyone die in front of you, especially someone that you love and someone that you look to for their approval in life, because you don't have the Lord, so you look for man's approval in all things, and that was him. So that rocked me big time. So I didn't go back to volleyball because I couldn't go in the gym without him, and I thought, I'll just do what the world does. I'm just going to go to my boyfriend's football games, travel all over the Big Ten, live this big high life, and everything's great. And guess what? It got worse. Got more depressed. Got more into just trying to fill anything, any void. And so thankfully, a guy on the football team said, you should come to Athletes in Action Summer Project out in Fort Collins for the summer. And I thought, oh my gosh, that sounds like boot camp. I don't read the Bible. I don't know all this kind of stuff. And I was reading through the application and it was like, what do you feel about John 4? I'm like, I don't even know what that is. And so he said, or it said, write your testimony. I'm like, I don't even have one. And so he said, I'll help you. And how funny, you know, like, here's a good Catholic. I'm like, can you help cheat on the test for my application and get me into the summer camp? And it's just kind of God's humor. So as he kind of went through it, I was like, I got to start reading this Bible. I got to start figuring this out. I don't want to be cheating on the exam to get into this camp. It's not an exam. It's, you know, just this application. And so I started reading the Word of God, and by the grace of God, I got it accepted with 62 other collegiate athletes to Fort Collins, Athletes in Action. And I showed up, and I was like, oh my gosh, these guys are perfect. Holy art thou. There's no way. They're going to find out, like, I'm not like them and kick me out, so I might as well just take off. And that was just Satan, just trying to be like, uh-uh, sister, you just stay out in the world. Nonetheless, got radically changed that summer and was able to learn how to share my testimony and do evangelism on the streets of Fort Collins and worked at a nursing home with the people that are going off to heaven anyway. So I was like, you need Jesus, you need Jesus, you need Jesus. And I came back to college and, you know, it was indifferent, right? I had this amazing summer, but it was like the same thing. My friends were like, all right, great, let's just still do our old thing, right? Like, you're not changed. I didn't have a body of Christ. And so I moved out to New York City and thought, oh, I'll find Jesus in New York. And I ended up getting into a cult. And when people tell you, like, oh, yeah, I got saved and my life was wonderful, no, it actually wasn't. I went through some crazy times. But within the cult, they really knew the Bible well, so praise God for that. I went to every Bible study 7 days a week. I went with the rich people, the IBM CEOs. I went with the poor people. I went with the artsies, you know, the models. I went to every different Bible study that New York City had to offer. And there was one scripture that I always remembered. It was Psalm 37:4, and I said, delight yourself in the Lord and he'll give you the desires of your heart. And I'm like, Father, I just want you. I just want you. Like, it can't be that hard, right? Just get me in the Holy Ghost filled church. That's like Acts 2 and we're going to do this thing. And lo and behold, I got an opportunity to go to Switzerland to be a snowboard instructor. I'm like, oh, so I stood up at the Bible study. I'll never forget it, in Soho, New York City. I'm like, so Psalms 37:4 says, delight yourself in the Lord. He'll give you the desires of your heart. Today, I just get a job as a snowboard instructor in Switzerland, and I have absolutely no credentials, no background in it, and Jesus did a mighty miracle, and I'm off to Switzerland. God bless. And I did. I just grabbed my little NIV thin line and my Beth Moore Bible studied, and I hightailed to Switzerland with Jesus, and everyone knew I was there because of Jesus. Well, that was amazing, obviously, but there wasn't this. I had no church body. I had an amazing job. I was in the Swiss Alps. Then I went to be a river guide in the south of France and with my little NIV and my Beth Moore study. But I didn't have the church. I didn't have the body. So when I got done with that, I was like, Father, I just want to be around people that love you, people that are just sold out for you. So I thought, YWAM, Youth with a Mission. I signed up, went to the discipleship training school, and headed out to Australia. And I was with the discipleship training school of backpackers because I just backpacked all of Europe by myself with my NIV Bible and my Beth Moore study. And now I got to go minister to people that were backpacking all throughout Australia, but with other Christians. Praise Jesus for the body of Christ, right? Very important. If you think you can do this alone, all of you guys watching on web that are not planted in the house of God, it is very difficult. You need to be plugged into the vein. There's a reason to come. It's not for your money. It's for you to really get filled up and to be plugged in. And so throughout YWAM, I just knew there was something greater. There was something, like, you know, that I was missing out on the things of God. I read in the Word of God, like seeing these signs, wonders, miracles. And I thought I was really called to orphans. At the end, you have to decide. You have a 6-week training where you go into 3 different parts. So there was orphans. The child's home, orphanage, a child's home, and then the prostitutes. And I'm like, oh, me, orphans, absolutely. And they're like, no, you have to go pray and fast and really hear from the Lord, and then, you know, we'll decide. I literally get in my tent, and it was the first time I heard from the Lord, and he purposely told me, you're going to the prostitutes. I'm like, I have nothing to say to them. Lord, I'm from Chicago. Like, what? What am I going to say to them? I hardly know everything in your word. Those people are way smarter than me. They can really go into that. That's like, I love the orphans. I'm good at that. And so I have a lot of scriptures that the Lord showed me, but in time here. So I get there and I say, okay, you know, I'll be the prostitutes. And the director of YWAM said, yeah, you are. You're leading the troop. I'm like, oh, whoa, 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 whoa. No, I'm just being on the team. I'm not leading. I'm not going to the front. He's like, no, you're going to go to the front and the Lord will supernaturally gift you. And that was like a turning point for me because that was dying to my own will for the first time. I didn't understand that. Didn't understand like, no, you do what God tells you to do because he's going to supernaturally gift you. And I got to Thailand and I met this girl, Janelle, and we had the same testimony down to dating the college quarterback, down to how we got saved. Everything. We're like, what? I'm like, this is crazy. And she's like, girl, we are made for such a time as this. We're the Esters in Thailand and these girls need us. And I supernaturally got the gift to speak Thai. It was crazy. She had been there for 4 years. She goes, how do you know this language? I'm like, I don't know, but the Lord has given me something. And we went into the bars that night to start praying for prostitutes. And the Lord just opened door after door after door after door. And we would just pull out these prostitutes. We would pray with them. And then came this word, deliverance. Now, remember, I'm a Catholic. I went off to Europe, and now I'm seeing prostitutes delivered in Thailand. So I'm like, hold on. Jesus did this. He said that he casted out the demons. Okay, are you sure? Okay, hold on. You know, just matter to make sure it's in the Bible and that you're not doing nothing crazy. And watching these women come out of a life of prostitution, I'll share one quick story. There was a girl. She was 6 years old, and she was sitting in a bar with her husband, or with her dad. And her dad was an alcoholic, and he couldn't pay the bar tab. And so they said, well, what are you going to do? And the bar owner was getting very, very angry, and he said, her, this is my tab. And he gave his six-year-old daughter to the bar. And that six-year-old daughter was now 12, and I got to meet her. And she had AIDS. She had STDs. She had been pregnant. And the ministry had been working with her for a long time. And nonetheless, they got her delivered. And literally before my eyes, I watched a girl completely transformed, completely made new. And I just cried, and I just kept crying and crying and crying. And I'm like, okay, I'll be back to the ministry. And I was crying and crying. I was like, that's what you mean. That's what you mean, Lord, that you make all things new. You've made me new. All my past is gone. You've made me new. You've made me whiter than snow. You made me the bridegroom. You made me the bride of Christ. I'm in those white wedding cloths. That's who I am. That's who I've been called to be. I don't know why I have to be in Pattaya, Thailand to find this out because I've been seeking you since 1998, but thank you for showing me this. And then from there, it was just like I was so hungry. I was so desperate. I was so desperate for the supernatural things. I was so desperate to see so many people not in religion, but changed for him. And so I came back to the States and I did nursing because I thought I could go save everyone through medical missions. And that's what I thought I was going to do because I'm so smart and I like to get in the way of God and do the things that I think he's called me to do. And I got done with that degree and I said, I'm going to San Diego. I'm going to die in Chicago. It is so cold. I mean, why do people even live here? And so I came to San Diego 10 years ago and I went to 26 churches. And I was so desperate to see the supernatural. I was so desperate to see people being set free from their past and all the things that I had just seen in this tiny, little, tiny, tiny, tiny town in Pattaya. And lo and behold, I was working, and some guy from this church said, can I pray for you? And I thought, praise Jesus. Yes, I like to pray for everyone, but sure, pray for me. And there was a power in his prayer. There was an anointing in the prayer, and he said, we have power of hour every Friday night. I'd love for you to come. And I'm like, you know, of course, I'm like the single one. I'm like, okay, no worries. Like, I'll find out on my own. Don't try to pick me up, but I'll, you know, if God wants me there, I'll be there. So I brought six girls. I said, hey, let's go to the church on Sunday. And my sweet Tyler, that everyone thinks was my little brother, got him to come, and his sister Sandy. And we were over at the other building, and I came to my first meeting at this church, and the hair on the back of my neck stood up, and I was still. I couldn't even move, and I was like, what is this? I have not felt this. I have not felt this anointing and this presence of the Lord, and I just bawled my eyes out. I put my hands up and I just cried. And I met Pastor Mark afterwards and I'm like, I've never found something like this ever in my life. This is amazing, but I have like 3,000 questions, and I'm coming blessed from this church, so I just want to be received because I'm so, right? I had to know everything from the Word. And so I'll never forget, Pastor said, yeah, well, do you surf? And I'm like, well, kind of, not good, but yeah, I can do that. That'd be great. So a couple of you guys and I went out and surfed with Pastor, and lo and behold, Pastor shares with me this mission about We Love Orphans and the Mission Training Center. And it was literally the exact thing that's been put on my heart that the Lord gave, exactly. And I just looked at Pastor and started tearing up, and I'm like, that's mine. And he's like, what? I'm like, that's my dream. That's what I want to do. He goes, well, we're going to do it together. And I said, praise the name of Jesus. Let's do this. And fast forward, because I know I'm running long, but I never thought I would marry this guy, ever, right? I came to the church, I'm like, he's amazing. Sandy, who ended up being my maid of honor, wrote that day that I came to this church for the first time, Allie met her husband. I was like, we're a few years apart, if any of you know, almost seven. But but God knew what we would need to be hooked up with. And I just want to close with this. There's not a coincidence that any of you guys are in this church. It's not by coincidence that you haven't been plucked out, because if you look around, this church isn't the same church it was 10 years ago. I mean, you can guarantee that. Praise God, Tyler stayed with me. I'm like, you're like the only one I know. You're not leaving. Now I married Lindsay. Praise God. She's been in the church since diapers. But you guys are here for such a time as this. You guys don't need to go to Pattaya. You don't need to go to Nepal. But you do need to be set on fire in the fire. You need to come to this church like Pastor Joshua was saying. Don't question what the authority in the house says. Don't. If Pastor Ruth says something to you, she's strong. Sometimes I'm like, oh my gosh, okay. But that's just from the heart. That's from the Word of God. That's from her hearing from the Lord to get things right. Don't take offense. Don't allow Satan to come mess in your lives, because I promise you, he will. I promise you, even to this day, I'm not holy art thou. I'm telling you, I'm the only reason up here, probably because I'm married to him with the same last name. There's nothing amazing about me that gets up here and takes a microphone. It's only what the Lord's done in and through me that makes me anything, that him shining brightly to me, bringing me to Laguna Beach to go preach Jesus. So anyway, I share that testimony back to being at this leadership conference with the top 2% of this whole company I'm in now. And this girl looks at me, and I look back at her, and she starts bawling, and she goes, your testimony is my testimony. I get you. I understand that. And I said, well, you have a decision right now. You can forsake all the things that God's forsake all the things in your life and accept God into your life right now. We can pray for you. We can break off the bondages of religion and break off the addiction and break off the generational sin that's been in your life. We can do that right now. She goes, I'm not ready for that. I'm like, okay, well, I'm not leaving until she's ready. So let's go back to eating. So we keep eating. And one of the leaders hits me, and she's like, go pray for her. You got the anointing. Go pray for her. Because that leader has been in the church, Natalie. She came down, and she came to the Joel Stockdale meeting. She's like, you pray for her. We're praying for her. I'm like, okay, let's just, you know, keep talking. So anyway, we keep talking. The Lord keeps putting things on my heart, and I just keep sharing. And lo and behold, I look at her. I say, listen, I got to go. My husband's got school of worship. I have a 1- and 4-year-old, but, you know, I want to pray for her. She's like, let's do it. The girl gives her life to Christ. We get to pray for her. We get to see her, you know, totally blessed, totally changed. And she's moving to San Diego in June. So you better believe I hope you all meet her in June. But nonetheless, there's been miracle since she's left. I mean, she got a new business partner straight from the Lord. Her husband, who said no to church, I'm not about it, blah, 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 is like, let's find a church. Let's do this. She has 2 kids that she's just now getting into kids' church. I mean, praise Jesus. And you guys, I just wanted to share that with you today, that like that, they're ripe for the picking. They are. But we need to get out of our own heads. We got to stop thinking like, oh, what do I say? Oh, I should call Pastor Ruth. She'll probably tell me what to say and give me a script. And then I'll just say the script. And then I'll walk her through a prayer. And then I'll bring her to church. And then when she comes to the church, then I'll debrief her. And then, like, that's literally how crazy sometimes we are. And I used to be that person. Because I brought so many people to this church when I first came. And every single one of them, besides Tyler Young, praise Jesus, isn't here. Right? So then I get in my own head. What's wrong with me? What's wrong with the church? What's wrong with these people? Oh, I'm so embarrassed. I don't want to bring them. They get scared of this. And then this person did that. And that person did that. No, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. Just be the light in the dark places. Be that person of joy. I love when Pastor Graham, Dr. Graham, all the Graham, he shared, people see the joy in him. They see the fruits of the Spirit demonstrated in his work. He doesn't go in his work and he's like, oh gosh, I got to see 22 patients today. I got this cough and now I got to church all night and get home till 1 a.m. Now I got to go. No, if he was grumbling and complaining, you're not going to get the workplace saved. I'll tell you that. But if you come in rejoicing and worshiping and there's like a glory on your head, but you went to bed at 1 a.m. and you had to get up at 5, God gives us supernatural strength. Amen. How many mommies in here know that? Yes. Who's slept in the past 5 years? Not me. So like we know that God will give us that, but we have to be willing and able, and you have to get out of your own mind. And I pray today, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name, that we would be used for great, mighty signs and wonders. Father, I thank you that we are called. We are called to this area in San Diego, Father, to show them that you are still a miracle healing God, Lord, that you do great, greater works, Father, and greater works shall we do. And Father, we commit today, Lord, to serving you with our whole heart, Father. We thank you so much, Lord, that we will see this nation turn back to you, Father. That will be because of our prayers, Father, that we will get in our prayer closets, Father, that we will not stop seeking you all day, every day. Father, I thank you in Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name, Father, that today people give their lives to you, Lord, that they will not live for themselves, but Father, they'll say, you and you alone will I serve. In Jesus' mighty name, Father, we praise you. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. So today, if you're in this place and you're like, you know what, listen, I've had a lot of me, I've had a lot of being in my head, I've had a lot of, oh, pastor's picking on me, it's the hot seat, it's all about me. No, he picks on me every day, I'm his daughter. I'm like, oh man, he's talking about me again. No, it's just you. It's you. You're in your own head. You're allowing Satan to say, oh, you know, he's just picking on me again. Be done with it. Today is your day. Today is your day to break free from that mental block, to break free from all that God wants to call you to do, to break free from relationships that are not of God. I mean, I love what Joshua said. Believe God for your husbands. Guys, this is crazy. On paper, us getting married, people are like, my dad had to fly out within 48 hours, thought I lost my mind. He's like, what? You don't even know this person? And I'm like, oh, yep, he's from God. It's had 3 dreams, da, da, da. I mean, he probably thought I was just out of my mind. Most amazing man I could ever imagine in my life, and just such a blessed marriage. Guys, I could not have gone through a near-death experience being married to anyone else but Joshua and having anyone else like in-laws like I do. Amen? Amen. So we want to pray with you all. We want you guys, I'm not even going to ask you what you need. I'm just going to pray for you. I'm just going to lay hands on you. But I want you to make a pact with yourself or whatever you need to do. I told the youth I got to minister in there that I do Sharpies on our mirrors. When I married him, he came over and he's like, how can you even see yourself in the mirrors? I'm like, doesn't matter. Just the word of God, man. That's who I am. Just the word of God. Because when I came to this church, pastor said about 3,000 scriptures within like the first like week. And I'm like, how does anyone know all this stuff? How do you remember all this stuff? My pen's on fire. And so then I would just write them all in my mirrors, like the pertinent ones that I could actually get down to paper so that I would know where they are when pastor asks, you know, like I know where they're at. But I encourage you, write those scriptures on your mirror today. Kids, ask your parents. But a Sharpie, and it'll be fine, or lipstick, whatever you need. But put those on there. If it's you, if you keep falling into the same thing time and time again, woe is me, everyone hates me, if you're like one of those people, no, be done with it. Tell yourself, you know what, I'm a new creation. The old is gone, the new is here. I am bright, white as snow. Women, if you need to know that about yourself, claim it. Claim it, and God will renew your mind. I'm a walking proof of the renewing of mind. There's many, many women in ministry that are powerful ministries that God totally renewed them from everything they were, and they are just on a rocket ship doing preaching versus the women that are like, oh, I'm just not good enough. I know no one likes me. No one invited me to the coffee. No, get to the coffee and bring 10 people. Don't worry about being invited. Promise you, you'll be welcomed. All right? Like my husband, I can keep flowing. But so we want to pray with you guys. And then we also want to share about an amazing thing that's happened at MTC. I am very passionate about the MTC. Now you kind of know my story that started over 8 years ago when I surfed with Pastor Mark first week at church, and he told me about MTC. This was before it even got started, actually. But we have an opportunity. Pastor Daniel and Summer are actually preaching right now in Bly, Oregon. Mike is going door to door, nonstop, bringing people to church, going back, picking up more people. I mean, just radical. I mean, we all knew he would do it. But we get an opportunity, you guys, to be a part of that. We get to be a part of every single soul. If you wanted to bring all this stuff to heaven that you have, so sorry. Treasure, store it in heaven. Only in heaven. Moss, people destroy everything you got, like Pastor said, his nice coat. Peace out. Everything we do that is eternal value is treasure in heaven. So I just got this, and it was like gold in my hand from Randy, because we are so excited to be hooked up with the Mission Training Center and the church that they are going to start building this May. And so these cards are in the back. Guys, it's only $60,000. Like Pastor said last week, one person could do it. I put both hands in the air. Babe, I received that. Amen. Yes, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And so each and every one of us, little kids, I mean, we got some major entrepreneurs up in the house. We can be hooked up supernaturally in faith to get this thing done today. Not June, not May. Is it May or June? May? May. Today, we can bring in the $60,000. So I want everyone to grab one of these cards in faith. And I promise you, you give not out of the abundance you have, but out of the abundance of your heart, that you want to sow seed to seeing people's lives saved, radically saved in Bly, Oregon and beyond, because we're going to get them up in the web. This is huge. So we're going to grab these cards as well, and we're going to give that offering. The offering's for you. It's not for us. You all know that. Pastor gives better offering messages than anyone. But we want to invite you, if you got stirred from this message, from what Joshua had to say, by the power of my testimony of what the Lord has done in and through my life, we want to pray with you guys. We don't want another day to pass where you're like, you know what? I'm still stuck in the mud. I'm still stuck in the same spot I was 10, 20, 30 years ago. God wants to change us in a twinkling of the eye. Like, seriously, March 29th, I should have been dead. That was, my number was up. I literally said, Lord, unto you can I commend my spirit. I knew I was dead. I knew it. And I knew my daughter was dead. And Pastor Mark called Anna back from the dead. There's so many radical stories that happened at 2:54 a.m., March 29th. And I know 5 years, it seems crazy this month, but when Pastor called her back from the dead, when Joshua grabbed my hand after the doctor said, we're going to let you Caesar stroke, there's nothing else we can do for you, and grabbed my hand, he said, babe, you're fine. And I am. Amen. It changes you. But you guys don't have to have a near-death experience to be changed. Consider your near-death experience today, knowing that you can change before you're at that point on that hospital bed. Amen. Amen. So why don't we all stand? When people come up for prayer, you can be just as active as praying for them in your seats. But please come forward. Any of you that want prayer, any of you that want healing, anything, if you have sickness or disease in your body, if you have mental problems, if you have anything that's blocking you, come forth. We are going to see a powerful anointing. We are going to see you change from glory to glory, never the same, in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah.
We seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. And I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. will call upon while he's near. You are my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Thank you. will seek the Lord while he may be found. And I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found. I will call upon him while he's near. You're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. Yes, I will seek the Lord while he may be found, and I will call upon him while he's near. For you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. My dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary. My dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary. My dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary. My dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary. My dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary. My dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. My sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Lord, you're my refuge, my sanctuary, my dwelling place, my shelter from the storm. Thank you. blazing sky. How wonderful your presence, Lord. How glorious your glory, God. How wonderful your presence, Lord. How glorious your glory, God. Of joy, Lord, in your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. We love all of you. Consider yourself dismissed. Don't, if you want to just stay in the presence of the Lord, by all means, we know and love each one of you. Welcome to be dismissed. Greet those around you. Bless them in the name of the Lord Jesus. Hug them and tell them you love them. Thank you.